Welcome to the Helix Center. This is the last program for the season. And before I introduce today's participants, let me tell you, we'll be going from fear to happiness as of September 24th. Watch for further announcements on our website, helixcenter.org. Now, today's participants, if you can raise your hand as I say your name. Nushin Hajikani, Associate Professor in Radiology, Harvard Medical School. Joseph Ledoux, University Professor and Henry Luce Moses Professor of Science, Center for Neuroscience and Department of Psychology, NYU. Eric Marcus, Director of the Columbia University Center for Psychoanalytic Training and Research, Professor of Clinical Psychiatry at Columbia University College of Physicians and Surgeons. Francis Lee, Mortimer Sackler Professor and Vice Chair for Research, Department of Psychiatry, Weill Cornell Medical College. Robert Kurzban, Professor of Psychology, University of Pennsylvania. Anyone can start.
So, Ed, are you going to?
No, I'm just going to wait for you to say something. Go ahead.
Okay, well, I guess I'll start. So, you know, as a psychologist turned into a neuroscientist of sorts, I think any kind of psychological question, whether you're approaching it in the brain or in behavior, always has to start from our introspections. I mean, that's our only access to our mental processes and internal states and so forth. So, you know, without being able to introspect and formulate the idea that we have a mind, that we have something called consciousness, we couldn't possibly study that. So there's no way that an organism that doesn't have that capacity to look inside its own brain and have its own ideas and formulate those, especially in verbal questions, statements like this, that allows us to say, okay, I'm aware that I have a psychology, a mind, and that's somehow related to my body, but also seems to have some kind of separate existence. All of that is only possible because of the kind of brain that we have. And we don't know which other animals obviously have that, because no other animal can tell us about this. So from the point of view of fear, we look into our brains and our minds and we say, what is fear? How are we going to study that in an animal or another person? And what we come up with is that, you know, fear is a kind of experience we have that we're in danger. So therefore, we can study what happens when an organism is in danger and learn something about fear. Now, the way we observe scientifically the fear of another organism, so to speak, is through its behavior or other reactions or responses. Obviously, we can't go inside another person or another animal's mind. So when I study a rat, and the rat is exposed to a threatening stimulus, and it freezes, the question is, what do we call that? For the last 30-something years, I and many of my colleagues have called that fear. But when I was talking about fear, and many of my colleagues as well, we weren't talking about fear as the conscious experience. We were talking about it as a kind of inner motivational state that connects stimuli with responses, so that a rat is freezing, or a human jumps back from a bus that's flying by before they're aware the bus is there, and so forth. And when that happens, we have these non-conscious systems that allow us to do this. At the same time, when we look into our minds, we both see ourselves jumping back and feeling afraid. So it all seems to be bundled together as one thing. And that's why the most common idea about how fear is represented in the brain is that you have a kind of fear circuit or fear center that we've inherited from animals. It's like, there goes back to Darwin, and or perhaps even older. And through the operation of that circuit, we both respond to danger and feel fear. I mean, that's the natural way to think about it. But as we begin to take these things apart, not so much in animal brains, because we can't really make the distinction, but in the human brain, we can begin to see that when we can create a threat by conditioning processes, expose the person to that threat, and the person will then respond to the threat. But if we present that, and the person will know the threat is there and so forth, but if we present that stimulus in a way that the person doesn't have conscious access to the stimulus, the person will still respond to the threat. So the heart will race, the palms will sweat, and so forth, even though the person never saw the stimulus and claims to feel no fear. So fear can't be what's driving these responses that are controlled by this part of the brain that I work on called the amygdala. Fear is what happens when we become aware that our brain is responding in this kind of way, and a lot of other things go into the creation of the fear as well. So this, and you can study patients who have what's called blind sight, where they're blind in the left side of space. You can present a threat there. You don't have to use any tricks or anything where it's presented very briefly. You can just present a threat to the left visual field, and if you're imaging the person, the amygdala will be activated and the responses will be present, but the person won't know the stimulus is there and won't feel anything. So, and I'll cut it short now. So because of this and many other kinds of pieces of information, I come to the conclusion that, you know, it was really inappropriate to talk about fear when I was studying the rats' responses to threats. What I'd been studying is the operation of a defensive survival circuit that allows the rat or any other organism to detect and respond to danger, and that can contribute to the feeling of fear, but that is not one and the same as the feeling of fear. The feeling of fear, instead, I think, is more of a kind of cortical process, neocortical process, where information about the present stimulus, memories about what that stimulus is and what it means, schemas about what kinds of emotions those are associated with and so forth, are integrated with the fact that, say, the amygdala is already being responding to the stimulus and all kinds of feedback is coming within the brain arousal and body feedback and so forth. And all of that is integrated in working memory to give rise to the feeling of fear. So that's my view of things.
So what's the value of making that distinction?
Well, the value is, and this is going to take some more time, is that okay?
Yeah.
So the value of it is that for the past 50 years, the pharmaceutical industry has been attempting to develop anti-anxiety drugs. And in 2010, GlaxoSmithKline and a couple of others began saying, we can't do it. Nothing's happening. You know, we're testing rats and mice in these chambers and giving them drugs that make them less timid, less behaviorally inhibited. But when we give them to people, it doesn't make them feel less fearful or anxious, or not reliably or consistently. So what's wrong? Well, the person, let's say a person with a social anxiety disorder on an SSRI, is more likely to go to the party, but still feel bad when they're there, because it's not reducing the fear and anxiety at the party, it's just changing the inhibitory behavior about going to the party. So if we make this broad distinction between circuits that control these behavioral responses and circuits that generate these kinds of subjective feelings, we can begin to ask questions about therapy and how it can be approached in a way that's more consistent with at least the way I think about how the brain is organized.
Joe, I think what you said is really crucial. I'm delighted to hear you say it, because being an analyst, I believe the mind can be studied, and also that the cerebral cortex in evolution is crucial. And you have just outlined that salient fact, that the brain in humans is complicated, it's layered, their levels, their connections, and many of the most interesting things about mental function are probably widely distributed circuits, maybe even whole brain. And that's crucial because it may allow us to begin to correlate cerebral neurophysiology with what analysts call meaning. And meaning is a tricky thing because, one, it's mind. Number two, it may be unconscious as well as conscious. Number three, big point, it's symbolically represented. It's symbolically represented. And when that happens, something's happening in the brain, both in word presentations and thing presentations, that stores this meaning for us. But it isn't mind, it is brain.
And as analysts, we deal with very paradoxical fear, which is called usually anxiety. Fear being something that has happened or about to happen, anxiety being something you worry about, that it might happen. And the anxieties that we look at as analysts may be unconscious in their contents, are often paradoxical. Patients fear what is not noxious for most people. Or even more so, they fear what is positively reinforcing for most people. And so we have to understand not the fear or the affect generated, but the affect meaning, the affect contents. Mark Soames is here, which takes me back to McCarley and Hobson, who when I was a young tad, just as a new attending out of residency, they gave a grand rounds at Psychiatric Institute. Big news, the dream has no meaning. Why? Because the generator of the dream is in the midbrain. I got up and dared to say, you know, when I was 3 years old, I saw my first movie, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. At the end of the movie, I turned to my mom and said, Mommy, what was that? And a kindly usher says, come here, kid, I'll show you. Takes me upstairs in the back, shows me the projector. He says, that's the movie. I say, wow, that's the movie. And I thought, man, I'll never understand grown-ups. This man over there said, you know what? They're actually wrong about the physiology of the dream. And began to show that higher cortical function is intimately involved in the dream. And that brought meaning back into the study of neurophysiology. It's a very tricky study because mind is not the same as brain. There are correlates, but the qualitative experience of mind is probably a whole brain experience. Consciousness is probably a whole brain experience. It doesn't mean that we can't have very useful correlations, but it does mean that as an analyst, I study mind and qualitative experience, not only event occurrences and quantitative experiences.
What would you say, Nushi?
I try to study how fear and anxiety are expressed in the brain when I do imaging of that. And that, of course, is a very artificial settings because what we do is we put people in big machines that make a lot of noise and we show them stimuli and they know that nothing is going to jump on them and attack them or anything like that. But still, we do see circuitry that gets activated for certain things. I was very privileged to once image this famous blindside patient, GY, who was... So we were first asking him, what do you see? He said, I see nothing. I said, but just guess, decide, press left or right, whether it's this or that. He said, okay, I'll do it if you want me to do it, but I really see nothing. But his guesses were better than chance. He was without being conscious of what he was seeing it. The interesting thing is it was not only fear he was seeing, it was also happiness, actually. He was reacting to happy stimuli as well. And so it was really amazing to see that somebody who was not conscious of something that he was perceiving was still able to show brain activation in all this circuitry that we know that are involved in the perception of
So you're saying that his perceptual circuits were lighting up?
Yes.
Yeah. And the cortex, prefrontal cortex, that
so
stuff?
No, so not the prefrontal cortex. That's the interesting part is that it was the earlier visual areas and motion areas and sort of mimicry even areas that were being involved, but not the prefrontal and not the parietal in his case. So that was, I think the prefrontal and the parietal cortex are essential for the experiential feeling of the emotion.
So to follow up on Joe's point, then in your human neuroimaging studies, I study mainly mouse threat circuitry. So have you found, based on what Joe has laid out, it would seem that we should find new areas in the human brain that have not been yet figured out by optogenetics or other things within the rodent brain that are related to fear? Have you, based on your sort of, I know, very laboratory-based still sort of paradigms, have you found other areas that have not yet been found in rodent brains?
I guess all the mirroring areas are not definitely, I don't know much about rodents, I have to say. I've always been
new. But I don't think it has to do with areas. Oh, we're talking about circuits that you couldn't pick up, you know, in an imaging situation. And certainly the rat or mouse prefrontal cortex is very different. Other primates have much more similar prefrontal cortex, but even in the differences between humans and non-human primates exist in terms of connectivity patterns and other kind of subtle connection and other things that wouldn't necessarily be that imaging wouldn't be sensitive to. Some of them are like the connectivity, but I agree with what you said that, my whole position has long been, my starting position, as many of our starting positions, is probably from our graduate student days. And I studied as a graduate student conscious experience in split brain patients and how information presented to the right hemisphere couldn't be accessed by the left hemisphere, but the left hemisphere could respond to the behaviors being produced by the right hemisphere and was always generating these complex explanations of why the behavior was being produced, even though it had no idea. Mm-hmm. And so this led Gazzaniga and I to this idea that part of the role of consciousness is to kind of tell a story about ourselves that sort of glues together all these random behaviors coming from all these unconscious processes, including so-called emotional behaviors. And as Freud said, consciousness is the tip of the iceberg. Most of what the brain is doing is under the radar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can I push you a little bit on that? If you take the research that you were talking about at GSK, so one way to read what you're saying is not only is that research in fact helping us understand how to suppress the feeling of anxiety, the sort of phenomenology of it. But one way to take what you're saying is it can't in principle, because the thing that we do in sort of as phenomenological beings, as humans, is just going to turn out to be different.
Right, but I would say it can't directly inform feelings, but obviously in a real emotional situation, unlike what we can do in humans in the laboratory, the feedback from all of this stuff. So, there are lots of things going on. Let's put it in terms of three consequences of amygdala activation that would impact, say, working memory and its ability to synthesize all of this information. One would be direct connections from the amygdala to cortical areas. Another would be outputs of amygdala and I'm just using amygdala as an example, not necessarily saying that's the answer to everything. The second would be connections from amygdala to arousal circuits in the brainstem that are going to, light up the brain and say something important's happened and cause attention to begin monitoring the environment, seeking an explanation, as in the old Schachter and Singer experiments where they arouse the people, put them in a situation where things were happy or sad going on and the people adopted the emotional tone of the context. Because what you're in an aroused situation, you have cognitive dissonance. Why am I aroused? Why am I feeling this kind of tension in my brain and body? And so you seek an explanation for that. So arousal is very important. But also then there's the feedback from the body, which is the key to Damasio's theory. I think that's one part of it, but not the entire explanation of where our feelings come from.
Yeah. And then there's a fourth one, right, Joe? Inhibitory tracks from the prefrontal cortex down to the amygdala.
Right.
Okay.
Well, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and the newer parts don't have any connectivity with the amygdala.
Very, very crucial point, right? That it's the higher levels that do.
Well, that's pretty high, dorsolateral.
Yeah. Well, prefrontal?
Dorsolateral prefrontal.
Yeah.
No connection to the amygdala.
Are there inhibitory tracks somewhere up there? Back down to the amygdala.
So dorsolateral and other prefrontal areas are connected to medial prefrontal areas, which do, in fact, connect to the amygdala. So the consequences of activating one of these defensive survival circuits, whether it's a threat circuit or a feeding circuit or anything else, is that changes take place widely in the brain. It creates a global organismic state within the brain and body that the body and brain then has to deal with. Now, one of the reasons that has moved me to this more cognitive view of fear and other emotions is the fact, if we just stick with fear, you know, we have to be able to not just account for fear as a defensive survival response. So we can be afraid of a snake at our feet, but we can also be afraid of starving to death. And that would not be part of the defensive survival circuit. That would be a homeostatic mechanism involving low energy supplies or dying of dehydration. So we begin to worry about that because our hypothalamic fluid balance circuits are out of kilter or are freezing to death in the sense of failure of thermoregulation. So these are not traditional threat circuits, but yet their activity can cause us to be afraid. And we can even move beyond that to broader fears, such as the fear of or anxiety of not leading a meaningful life or of the eventuality of death, an existential kind of threat. So a circuit, you know, if you say fear, the amygdala is the brain's fear center, is, as is often said, you can't possibly get to an explanation of both existential fear and the fear of a snake in one explanation. So it's, there's only one way you can do that. It's through a cortical processing of all these various kinds of inputs. Fear is a kind of construction or an assembly or an emergent property of a lot of ingredients that happen below the surface.
Yeah. Now, Joe, you have taken fear and applied it to the fear of not leading a happy or satisfactory life. An analyst would say, no, that's anxiety, actually.
No, I said fear or anxiety.
Ah, okay.
No, in my book.
I think that whole discussion about fear and anxiety is not settled, because I still, no matter how much I look into it, I can't see what exactly differentiates one from the other. But that's another matter. You were going to say.
Well, right. So I do wonder a little bit about the extent to which these are semantic issues and to what extent they're contentful. So, for example, it seems like it could be that when we talk about the fear of not leading a meaningful life and the fear of getting hit by a train, that we're using the same word. But in fact, it's going to turn out that in sort of an Aristotelian sense, we haven't carved nature at its joints properly in mm-hmm. the natural language. And so my bias scientifically is always as a splitter as opposed to a lumper. Mm-hmm. And so it seems to me that it could plausibly be that there's lots of systems which, if you kind of squint at them, they kind of look like they're doing more or less the same kind of thing, keeping us from doing it. So, for example, you know, getting us to eat when we're hungry or worrying about the fact that we might not. Mm-hmm. But that when all is said and done, when we're all done with our work, whether we're talking about the cognitive level or the neurophysiological level, we're going to look at these things and say, oh, it actually turned out that those things were of a family in the Eleanor Roche sense of family resemblance, but they weren't exactly the same thing, mm-hmm. right? And so I have a fear that my microphone just dimmed.
or were you anxious?
Or I might have been anxious about it, yeah.
I agree with that. But the point is that so the field has been so narrowly focused on fear. I'm saying let's consider all the options mm-hmm. and whittle back from there rather than, you know, kind of just being stuck in this defensive mode where, you know, a snake is the canonical form of fear. When we know that people never encounter snakes in New York City, and yet there are a lot of fearful and anxious people in New York.
So maybe...
Including fearful about snakes that they have never seen.
Exactly.
Well, they're also human snakes, Ed. Much more frightening. So an analyst would say, look, if you want to study brain physiology about human fear and anxiety, you have to look at the neurophysiology of meaning. And probably that means you have to look at the neurophysiology of representation.
I'm not sure I completely agree with what you say, because I think in some cases you can put people in a state chemically that will make them experience anxiety even if they have no reason to experience anxiety. So if you flow your system, for example, with thyroid hormones, your blood pressure is going up, your heart is beating, you have all these symptoms that are normally present when you experience fear, except there is no stimulus that would provoke
fear.
And what
does the
and
person
yet,
say?
You feel anxious. You have the deep feeling of being anxious, even if you know there is no reason to be. So I think that there is no meaning there, but the body is still sending a signal and makes us interpret yeah. whatever the signal is as anxiety.
Those people who have panic attacks say, I feel like I'm going to die.
Yes, but they have that's different because they have a condition that makes them have
absolutely.
Panic attacks. What I'm telling you is if you do that to a perfectly you know, normal, if there is such a thing, person, a healthy person who is feeling well, you give them this medicine, and then suddenly they will have this huge surge of anxiety.
Yeah.
And that, I think, is interesting because it also shows that things can just arise from body signals into the
Pheochromocytoma. But often, either it's true free-floating anxiety, which is rare, or the person, even though they know it's physical, has a mental experience of it. It has a representation to it. They can say, oh, what does that feel like? Feels like I'm going to die. Feels like I'm suffocating. Feels like I'm falling.
Yeah, but what does that tell you? I mean, you could say anything.
Wait a minute, you could say anything. Ed, you're an analyst. Yes, you could say anything. But what you do say may be actually influenced by who you are, right? And the question...
Maybe so, or maybe what you heard. Maybe you heard people who have panic attacks think they're dying, so when you have a panic attack,
they don't think they're dying. They don't necessarily think they're dying. They say it feels like they're dying. Right,
but maybe you have, you know, especially in these days, you go on the internet, it says people who have panic attacks, they think it feels like dying.
It doesn't matter if they say it feels happy like a lollipop, that's fine. We're not talking about the content, the specific content, but only that affect in human beings tends to have a content. And that if you want to understand the human experience of affect, you have to understand what Joe has already said, that there are links between cognition and affect and physiology, and that the package deal in humans tends to be represented in that package deal, and they will express it. We call that package deal in human beings meaning, the meaning of the affect.
Francis, you're a psychiatrist and a neuroscientist. What do you think of that?
It's hard to say because I'm actually a neuroscientist. It's much easier for me to think about it. What I was actually thinking about as you were saying this was actually about there's a certain group of patients that were studied at the University of Iowa who basically had congenital lesions of their amygdalas. You're familiar with these groups. And that recently there was a paper that came out a couple of years ago that if they were given some type of carbon dioxide sort of inhalation, they actually felt for the first time a fearful response. Or at least they had
it was just showing that they could feel
they could have a physiological response but did you, like, for those people, they still have they still felt fear in some on other things, like as you said, these are great subjects because they have thoughts that they probably have fears that their life has no meaning or various other things.
But I mean, that's part of my argument against the idea that the amygdala is a fear center.
Exactly.
Because these people can have fear without an amygdala.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Even though they don't have the physiological response of whatever, if you put them in the laboratory and shock them and put a yellow square in front of their face, you know, and then they won't freeze or have a physiological response to that.
And the amygdala is the key to the output.
Yes,
to those circuits that control those responses. So.
But if you interview them, they will actually say
I mean, Liz Phelps actually, is at NYU, showed this with Adam Anderson, I think, in 2002. Yeah. It didn't get as much attention as the Iowa paper did more recently, but it's the same effect that you can have, that the amygdala is not involved in the experience of these emotional responses, or these emotional states, but only in the expression.
But I actually prefer to think of the amygdala as a relevance detector, as has been proposed by some people, because I think it's present in a lot of tests that I do. For example, if I just show neutral faces versus objects, faces are more relevant to us because they're biological stimuli. I get amygdala activation even if there is no fear involved in those faces. So I think we need to broaden our view.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about fear, so we talk about the amygdala, there's a dozen parts of the amygdala. Take only the lateral nucleus of the amygdala, that we can divide into three parts. One that is involved in plasticity and learning, another that's involved in the transmission to other amygdala areas and so forth. So the circuitry is, I mean, in an imaging study, you can see, you know, positive and negative and all of that in the blob called the amygdala. But when we get into the detail, and that's why the animal studies are important, we can see the circuitry cells that will respond to positive but not negative and so forth. So mm-hmm. at a subtle level of microwiring, mm-hmm. there are these distinctions. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what it is you know, I think what we have to think about is a circuit that is detecting threats by predators versus circuits that are responding to positive incentives okay. versus mm-hmm. circuits that are responding to dehydration or changes in temperature. All of those are going to, you know, may overlap, but they're also going to be crisscrossing, mm-hmm. and you're not going to be able to pick that up through through you know, crude imaging technique. I'm sorry, crude. Where it is today, but you know, I think the
less usual, crude. It's less crude.
Less crude. The usual idea is that you can the ultimate resolution yeah. of the magnet will be somewhere along the idea of a cubic millimeter, right?
Yeah, and having that is a very tricky part because you have all kinds yeah. of things around that makes it difficult.
Yeah,
to
yeah. Like one of the early studies of Mark Rakel's that implicated the amygdala turned out to be jaw muscle rather than the amygdala.
Really? Yeah. That's amazing.
But Joe, you're saying something so important, which is the complexity even of the amygdala, right? The complexity of the brain and how its function is overdetermined and multi-determined, which is an analytic concept. Welder based on Freud. And it's a basic physiological fact about the human brain and how it functions.
I wanted to ask you something, Joe. You said that people take the tranquilizers and it doesn't take away their anxiety.
SSRI. That's even more interesting.
I didn't say tranquilizer.
It's an antidepressant.
I said SSRIs.
So what about when you take actual tranquilizers, anti-anxiety medication?
So, okay. I mean, we'll get into the details. So there are receptors for benzodiazepines in prefrontal areas as well as the amygdala and all over the brain. So the question is, two questions, I guess. One is, when a person is feeling less anxious on a benzodiazepine, is that because, one, the benzodiazepine has specifically reduced anxiety, or is there a more general change of emotional processing? And if it's a second question would be, is it because you've changed emotional processing per se, or because you've changed the cognitive underpinnings of that emotional processing by blunting activity? You know, mm-hmm. benzodiazepines are GABA agonists, so they mm-hmm. blunt activity wherever they bind. So if you blunt cognitive processes that are involved in the assembly of higher thoughts or even fears and anxieties in prefrontal cortex, then you're going to feel less fearful or anxious. But have you done that by directly changing anxiety? Mm-hmm. You might say, okay, as a therapist, it doesn't matter. You know, if it works, it works. That's great. But as a scientist, you want to know why it's working. And is it doing what you say it does? Because mm-hmm. that's what's led to billions of dollars being mm-hmm. spent trying to make animals less timid yes. in these behavioral situations, to find drugs that can make people less fearful or anxious.
What do you think, Francis, about this?
I still am amazed as a psychiatrist and as a neuroscientist that we don't actually know where the site of, or what circuit or what network is being affected by the benzodiazepines. We've been giving them for decades. And you would think that there would have been a conditional receptor knockout mouse that would have been done at some point. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, that has not been. Because
the pharmaceutical industry moves in the direction of, okay, we've got this drug.
Yes.
Let's get the next one with exactly. a tweak to it that'll make more money, right?
Yeah.
So they're not going to figure it out.
They're not going to figure it
so
out.
So scientists have to do that. And
yeah. But
I do have a clinical piece of data for you.
Okay.
I took once a benzo, Librium, for a plane flight.
Yes.
My brother met me. Mm. He said to my wife, the plane landed at noon. Eric landed at 1.
Well, we're on this. Yeah.
Well, it wasn't only fear, a loss of fear. It was, wow, a really good feeling.
While we're on the subject of ethics, for example, giving people drugs, which we don't really know how they work for the last decades. And
We used to give people aspirin. For yeah.
And on this note of social anxiety, I don't often have the chance to talk to people in the clinical world. So I'm interested in this story, for example, about the introvert who we medicate so that they go to parties, which they subsequently presumably are very difficult for them, right? Because they're introverts, so they actually don't really like going to these sort of social events, right? And one way to read introversion is that's Darwin's way of saying, you know what, you should maybe devote your attention to the non-social stuff, because whatever the social stuff is doing for you is really not working out. So mm-hmm. there might be other ways. Should we be suppressing anxiety to the point where we get people into situations which are subsequently going to be unpleasant, even if I may, maladaptive for them? Is this something that we do in the clinical community? I was not aware. Other than I was aware that we give people all the time medications which we don't understand how they work.
Yes.
That's yeah. I'm cool with that.
It's called being a doctor.
Yeah, that's cool. I've always been impressed with my friends over in the medical community. See, how devoted they are to empiricism. Without
we haven't even medicine. Known to ask that question because it's all seemed like one thing in the brain, you know, fear and anxiety, like fear center, anxiety center.
Yeah.
Happiness center.
But there are some things that are a touch more specific. I don't know how they work. But people who have stage fright, they respond to in the rouse.
I think that has not become solid as it used to be.
And also,
meaning,
what response?
What does that
mean? The subsequent studies have not been as clear.
Ed, the question is, what response in the rouse? The tachycardia, the sweating, that the tremor, that response in the rouse. They then have to say, if they can, wow, nobody can now see that I'm anxious. And the anxiety may, in certain people, fade because of that.
Or maybe because you don't get this body response, you feel better because
that's
you don't get
same
all
thing.
The signals.
But, that, right.
you know,
that's the,
but that's the key.
That's the previous understanding. What you're saying that,
that's
Joe,
the
that there's new sort of doubt
right.
that this is
the Well, I actually think that Enderol does work because...
did you take some before you...
No. But if we have... if we condition rats in a certain way that make them avoid... situations, we find that there's a group, about 20%, that never acquire the response. But if we inject propranolol or Enderol directly into their central amygdala, which controls the outputs to the freezing and all that, the animals stop freezing and start performing the response. So they can now approach the threats and so forth. So it has this, in the traditional sense, an anti-anxiety effect in terms of behavior. Right, but I wouldn't call that anxiety. I would call that reduced defensive behavior or reduced behavioral inhibition. That would be consistent with the effects of Enderol given to people. You give it to them and they're more willing to go on stage and perform. So the body feedback and all of that that's suppressed would indirectly make you feel less anxious, even if the Enderol itself is not directly reducing your anxiety.
I wanted to get your opinion. What did you think of the recent study that came out about giving, since we're talking about Enderol, where they were conditioning humans who had a spider phobia to, and then they sort of brought up, they did essentially a reconsolidation type experiment where they gave the Enderol during that window. Mm-hmm. Did you actually, I wonder, was
this the Dutch study?
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to comment on
that.
There's some issues. I don't want to go.
You mean in terms of experimental design?
In general, yeah.
Okay.
But apropos drugs, we don't know how they work and why they work. Mm-hmm. Have you seen this study that showed that paracetamol, which is something you'll take for pain, actually alleviates social pain in these games where you give the ball to people and ignore them and so forth. And I thought that was also something that's interesting in terms of circuitries interacting and crisscrossing. Mm-hmm. Because who would think of paracetamol as an anxiety drug?
Do they know how it works or?
Don't know how. Yeah, I mean, it's a COX-2 inhibitor. It's an
interesting.
But it's nobody really completely understands how paracetamol works, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, currently at Cornell, there's a clinical trial which we're doing. I'm a sort of a very small member of this clinical trial, but it essentially is looking at people with post-traumatic stress disorder. And this was an anti-tuberculous drug called D-cycloserine. It had gone by the trade name Siromycin. And it had previously been thought of by serendipity to be actually opening up the glutamate NMDA channel. But what people have found is that it can be given at short time periods as a cognitive enhancer. And so what the trial we're doing is we're actually giving them about 45 minutes to an hour before their cognitive behavioral exposure treatment. They get this drug and or a placebo, and then they do their exposure treatment. So we're actually going to see whether this works. This has been all been very well worked out by Mike Davis, a researcher at Emory University in rats. But this is one that had been initially been worked by Kerry Ressler to decrease phobias of fear of heights. But now we're going to do something much more complicated in looking at something that is, even though post-traumatic stress disorder is considered to be something that has elements of fear and anxiety, it's so much more complicated than that. And I think we're going to see whether or not this at least helps it's not monotherapy for the PTSD, but it's actually going to be used in conjunction with exposure mm-hmm. therapy.
I think there's been a few meta-analyses recently that suggest the effects, like many things, you get an effect in the first study, right?
Yes, the biggest effect.
Now it's starting to fall apart.
Yeah.
So that'd be interesting to see what you get on that.
You mean meta-analysis in the rodent models or in the humans?
No, in humans. A lot of Stefan Hoffman and Mike Lotto at BU have done a lot of that stuff.
Exactly. And it seems that the things that don't work for D-cycloserine are things like snake phobias. Like if you have some type of certain phobias are not as amenable to this. But again, we don't actually know where this works. Mm-hmm. There have been some studies that suggested affects both the amygdala, firing rates in both the amygdala and also the prefrontal cortex. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's been as clearly mapped out unless I've missed some paper.
Yeah. But that would go along with representation, right? Meaning, yes. Significance of.
Yes.
Which is a prefrontal concept. It's silly to say that because I'm arguing against that whole concept. But
yeah. So I'm just going to take a moment. And I have a new book out called Anxious. So it's a little promotion there. But in the book, one of the things I propose is that, you know, that because if in fact the conscious experience of fear is distinct from these more basic threat processing circuits, we might profitably approach exposure therapy by directly attacking the amygdala independent of conscious awareness by using subliminal presentations of the CS, of the spider or the snake or whatever, and reduce the amygdala's responses outside of consciousness, then do conscious exposure therapy.
Yes.
And then do psychotherapy mm-hmm. to help the person cope with the situation, kind of a 3-point plan. Right. What do you think of that?
Look, I think that's potentially terrific. An analyst would either after you're done or before or instead of ask the question, why is this person afraid of spiders? Do they have a traumatic history with spiders? Many don't.
Right.
What do spiders mean to them? If you will, what activates the affect circuit? What's the affect meaning? And then get the story of that, so that the person themselves, in a certain other circuit, more cognitive circuit, understands something about the symbolic representation spider and may deal with the actual elements of what they are afraid of behind the spider image. That is crucial.
Suggestion is a very, very powerful tool. So you can change things by suggestion. It's the equivalent of placebo. So,
Ed, placebo is a very powerful thing. You can see it in the brain. Yeah. You're changing the terms of the discussion from is there meaning to how do you know the meaning and does the meaning work. I was addressing only that there is a symbolic representation of meaning. That's all.
But if you take anybody, any student that comes, and you put them in a magnet and you show them subliminal images of snakes, mm-hmm. you'll see their whole fear circuitry that lights up. Do you think it has a meaning to them? Do you think the snakes, the fear of snake, is coming because of a meaning? Or do you think it's just something?
Yeah, don't you think that people feel, oh my God, the snake might bite me or get inside me?
They don't know it's there.
No, you rapidly show it.
Okay, now we're talking about the analyst's view of the unconscious. They don't know it's there. Yes, that's right. The whole analytic theory of human mental function and neurotic pathology is that there are aspects of meaning of it of which we're not aware. And all of the analytical literature on techniques, it talks about how to make that unconscious conscious. Maybe it's baloney. Maybe it doesn't work. Maybe it's just placebo. Different question.
Yes.
The idea, however, the analytic idea is human meaning is there and may be unconscious.
So, I mean, no, but my point is not that. My point is, you show snakes to anybody, and anybody will have these reactions.
Right, because of the meaning of snake.
So you mean that you think everybody has a problem with snakes because of their history?
No. Everybody's afraid of falling. But the falling is conceived of representationally. It's not just stimulus reflex. That's all I'm saying.
But what I understood this to be would be that Joe was throwing out that there should be a clinical trial where you do treatment as usual or to add on top of it this type of subliminal...
No, but I think it's normal. It's a normal reaction. That's we evolved.
Of course, representation
having
is normal.
Fears of things that are dangerous for us, snakes, spiders, heights, etc. Yeah. So I think that's a normal thing to have a reaction to when it becomes a problem that interferes with your daily action. Then it's a problem that you need to solve. But otherwise, I think it's a normal thing that we have. It's like we see faces everywhere. Yeah. We can see objects that look like a face, and in 170 milliseconds, you will activate the areas of your brain that normally sees real faces because you're
predisposed.
That's all I'm saying.
That's the design.
That's
the design.
Yeah, that's the design.
You can't.
And that's why babies orient to faces after just a few minutes of life, because we have the subcortical system that orients us to things that are important for evolution.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that doesn't need to have extra, meaning.
We're saying the same thing. Meaning is innate to human beings. That's what we're saying.
I think you need to be careful to put meaning to some of these things. I think you are putting meaning to everything, but you don't need meaning. In other words, the person who has the fear, who goes under these imagings and they all respond to snake fear, the snakes don't have to have any other meaning for them. There's no unconscious meaning to it. The only meaning is that evolutionary, we are going to have to guard ourselves against snakes.
Okay, Ed, you're now reducing meaning to its minimalist significance, which is fine, but now you want to take a step further and say it has no meaning at all. Snake doesn't even mean snake. It's innate.
It means snake.
Okay, so snake has a meaning.
That's
snake
only
means
because
bad.
We have given it a name.
Excuse me? It has meaning only because we've given it a name?
I mean, in terms of meaning, if it's,
wait a minute, it has meaning
it's a
only
dangerous
we've given it a
animal.
Name?
We have to protect ourselves.
So I would just go back to one of the things you said to kind of tie it into this.
Exactly.
You said the job of the analyst is to make the unconscious conscious. But if the meaning is wired into, say, the amygdala, there's no way to make that conscious. I mean, the circuitry, because the prefrontal cortex can't look at the amygdala and see what it's doing. You know, there's certain things that are certain things that are unconscious because of wiring, not because of repression.
Oh, no, that's right. But there are actual fibers from the amygdala to the precortex. I asked you about that.
Right.
And they're actual fibers back down again.
No.
And so,
okay. I mean,
one could inhibit one's amygdala responses. We do it all the time, right?
Yes, we're good at inhibiting, but less good at,
the other way.
The other way, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the asymmetry there is that it's very easy for the arousal of these emotions, whatever you want to call them, to affect our conscious experiences.
Yeah.
But less easy for our conscious experience to change our emotions, as we all know. That's why you are in business.
Right.
Exactly.
Right. You're thinking.
Well,
something.
No. I mean, so I would just add to that. So, I mean, again, I feel like this notion of meaning, ironically enough, turns out to be a semantic issue. So, it might be helpful for some of us to understand what it would look like for something not to have meaning, because the examples that I think I'm accustomed to seem intelligible in this kind of Darwinian context without needing anything additional. But on this note about consciousness and so forth, I mean, I think most of us sort of take the view that it's interesting. I feel like all of the discussion about the fear of dehydration has led to this moment right here. I think that most people would agree that a signal feature of the mind, and this goes all the way back to the early work on split brain patients and so on, is that there's modularity. That is, there are systems that are isolated from each other, again, not in virtue of a suppression sort of, but the fact is that, you know, there's lots of stuff going on in our heads that they just do the little things behind the, you know, behind the veil, and it's just fine that they do those sorts of things. Mm-hmm. And I take it that that's why you get many of the effects that you do. And another way is just to bring this back to the very top of the conversation, which is, you know, if you sort of take that view, that then the question of what consciousness is doing. Now, maybe it's a narrator along the lines of Kazanaga and so on that's here to tell us stories. But that does bring me back to the point about rodents, which is that if you think that what's going on in terms of phenomenology and consciousness has to do with telling stories in the social world, then critters that don't really talk to each other, which is, you know, every other species more or less, roughly, at least with natural language, they wouldn't need that. And which, so one direction that does sort of point you is to make, it makes you think a little bit about if phenomenology has to do with the narrator, then maybe it's something unique, which again would then go all the way back to this discussion of what the animal research is telling us on these topics.
Yeah, I'm with you. I mean, I'm reluctant to say it's unique because we don't know. But I would say that if animals have phenomenology, it can't be anything like what we have with language. I mean, as soon as an experience begins to develop, we are labeling it and defining it and giving it meaning through our words and our history and our experiences. So, you know, we have 37 words in English for variants of fear and anxiety, and That must be an important kind of emotion for us because we have so many words for it.
Just like don't we have that many words for snow? We have that many words for snow too, right?
And to go back to your not understanding the difference between fear and anxiety or not accepting it. I mean, so I think the usual view, I'll state it as I know it, which is that fear is an emotion that you experience when the threat is present or expected and imminent, whereas anxiety is a worry about something that hasn't yet happened and may never happen.
Well, I know, I mean, once you start digging deeper into any of these distinctions, you find holes in them.
So what are the holes?
Well, if I recently saw that you can have people subliminally do something and where they could cheat or not cheat, and subliminally affect their views about right or wrong and religion. And if you put in the ideas about religion, they are more liable not to cheat.
Right.
Now, is that anxiety or is that fear? Because what the idea is has to do with the notion of God.
I would say it's neither.
So God is watching.
Neither.
No, so God is watching you, and God wants you to do the right thing. So is that fear or is that anxiety?
Well, but I mean, are you saying only the religious people went in that direction?
When they introduced religious ideas and the subliminally, the people cheated less because of the notion of right or wrong and the fear of God than when they didn't.
So let me give you, let's change the example.
But
Ed, you're not going to know unless you ask the person.
No, you won't doubt when they
Now we're back to the movie projector in the movie, Ed.
No, we're not.
Yes, we are.
No. If you think about fear of anxiety, you yourself...
I like
when
that.
You
if you
speak
think
about
it, that's
no,
the point.
No,
if
but
you
when
think
you
about it,
when
if you
speak
have an experience
about
it, mental.
When you speak about it, you are going to use in certain situations the word fear, when in fact, with the definition that Joe gave, you should be using anxiety.
Not necessarily,
any
you have
situations,
to ask the person.
No, that's not
yes.
the point.
No, it's not important. Okay, an analyst says. Ask the person how they experience that. Some people experience God as a living presence.
I'm going to go back to the experiment.
Not what we are referring to.
So let's go back to the experiment. So I can give you a very similar experiment, but it has nothing to do with God. John Barge, who's used to be at NYU, now at Yale, did studies at NYU where he brought in participants in the study and had them unscramble the blocks of words, you know, had to reassemble words and sentences from blocks. And so there were two kinds of sentences that were scrambled like this. One kind had to do with sentences about old age, and another kind had to do with just random things, nothing about old age. And these were all undergraduate students. And so the students who unscrambled sentences about old age took longer to walk down the hall afterwards than the others.
Just as a side note.
I wouldn't call that fear or anxiety. It's activating non-conscious schema.
That's a different example.
Let's finish. Let me just finish with that. So you had in your study, they were responding to, they were being, what were the stimuli again?
I don't remember the details. I read this some time ago, but it had to do with when they subliminally introduced ideas, religious ideas, then the cheating was less.
So we have these non-conscious schema that are kind of sitting there where they classify information as it comes in before it reaches consciousness. So you can activate these schema with probes or primes like religion, old age, blah, blah, blah. And then that becomes part of your conscious thought process because you've been primed to do it. It's the classic priming thing which happens unconsciously but bleeds into consciousness. So I don't think it has to do with fear.
Joe's talking about unconscious schemas, which we call representation. He's got a much more complicated view of the mind than you do right now.
No, that's not that doesn't solve the problem of the distinction between fear of anxiety.
No, that's a different example. No, but he's saying that's not the issue, Ed. It's more complicated than that.
I don't know what you mean by more complicated. What I'm saying is there are many definitions and many attempts at distinguishing fear and anxiety, and I don't find that there are any of them that are foolproof.
Because you're looking
at
the definition.
And you yourself, when you were talking about it before, you said fear and anxiety. Because if it were possible to make as clear a distinction as between fear and something else, we wouldn't have this discussion.
Well, so there's obviously a fuzzy zone.
There is something fuzzy about that distinction. Right.
It's not
and
a
it's
question
important
of definition,
in psychoanalysis.
But it's not a question of definition. You won't find the answers in words and in epistemology. You have to find the answer in the mental experience, and Joe has shown in the brain.
Well, of course you have to find the answer in the brain.
So you can't argue that any definition has holes in it, because that's not the point, of course. Any definition of anything does. It's the mental experience, and it's neurophysiology.
You're totally misunderstanding.
Suppose we work backwards from the concept.
We're not talking about definitions in that way.
Work backwards from worry.
You are, not me.
Oh. Okay. What about fear being acute and anxiety being more chronic?
Well, that's one of the others.
Well, that's the same thing that we're talking about, that fear is a response to an immediately present stimulus. Anxiety is a worry about the future. But suppose we start with worry and say that threats that we worry about are anxiety, but when the threat is present, it's fear.
No, so let's say you are sitting alone at home and you suddenly start thinking, what if I'm alone and somebody breaks in?
Yeah, that's anxiety.
And then you go and you check the door double, make sure it's double locked and so on. Is that fear
or anxiety?
So for you, the temporal element is supreme. So on this kind of view, I can't fear that something is about to happen to me. I can be anxious about it.
If it's imminent. So if for example, a rat in a box. Well, let's forget rats. So let's say that every time you touch this bottle, you get an electric shock. So
that happened, by the way.
Even though you're not touching it, you know you're going to get shocked. So you would say that you're afraid because it's there. Whereas anxiety would be, the next time you come here, you're worried that there might be a bottle that will shock you if you come in.
I mean, can't we just settle this by fiat, right? So we're scientists, right? Don't we get to decide what words mean?
Yeah, the problem with that is that we get, when we do that, I mean, that's what Byfield did a long time ago. It decided fear was a non-conscious or non-subjective state, motivational physiological state that connects threatening events with responses. But they called it fear, and they use it to try and help people feel less fearful or anxious and explain fear and anxiety in people. So when, as soon as you do that, you're out of the non-subjective and into the subjective, and nobody makes the difference. So people will go to the Society for Neuroscience, has 1,000 posters on freezing rats and talking about curing anxiety in people.
Right.
So I think we have to be very careful when we redefine things scientifically. When we take common language words and redefine them scientifically, we open ourselves into trouble when we're talking about things that everyday people experience.
Let me ask you my terms then. So again, as a Darwinian guy, my guess is that what you're really ultimately going to be pointing to are systems that have different functions. So one function might be, you know what, I need to incubate about something that might happen because that's going to help me down the road. So I think we all agree that a certain amount of anxiety isn't such a bad idea because it potentiates planning for those eventualities which pose threats. So one kind of a system would be a forward-looking system that maybe simulates something which might be threatening. Another one is a system that's designed to take appropriate evasive action given what has happened in the past. And that, of course, fits with some of the learning stuff, right? So if we start to carve the world in terms of functions instead of by fiat, do you feel like that might get us in a productive direction? Would that satisfy your friends at the
what
society?
What I would say is anxiety is a byproduct of the fact that we have a brain that can imagine the future.
And
so you don't think it's a byproduct. So in my world, since we're talking about semantics, so in my world, that means you think it doesn't have a function, that it's sort of non-functional.
Well, it has a function once it exists. I mean, but the reason...
It's not there in virtue of the fact that it did some particular job, is what you're saying.
Anxiety, I would say.
Really? I mean, I find that remarkably unlikely, but, you know...
Your ability to imagine how to build a building is not that different from your ability to imagine that building is going to fall down on you.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I mean, it seems to me we could have the ability for this kind of planning with respect to building in terms of that could be an artifact manipulation system. Mm-hmm. Like that's working memory allows me to think, hey, what if I strung the bow this way? Mm-hmm. It could be a different system, although it makes use of some of the same components, where I think about what are all the things that might go wrong that maybe I should plan for. So, for example, maybe I should make my buildings with stuff that makes them less dangerous or unlikely to whatever. So it seems like certain kinds of anxiety, it seems to me, like you wouldn't want to suppress all kind of anxiety. So Randy Nessie, who's the only psychiatrist I sort of know, lives in my world, and he has this example where, you know, if you're a mouse and you have, if you get anxious every time you smell, you know, feline urine, then so you scurry away, that's kind of a good thing.
I wouldn't want a psychiatrist. Mouse is not anxious.
So he's not anxious at all. Right. I see. But you certainly wouldn't want to give him any.
Having a threat response, right?
Yeah. How would you distinguish his behavior from a subjective state? I mean, the only way we can do that in people is to ask them.
Mm-hmm. Of course, people can lie.
They can, but, you know, at least we...
And in fact, your work shows they can be wrong, right? So all the split brain works.
That's not the point. The point is that in humans, we're all operating with the same kind of brain. But when we go to another animal, they're operating with a different kind of brain. Mm-hmm. And the way the human brain is different isn't exactly the circuits and so forth that... allow us to experience our world.
Let me put it a different way. If you could eliminate everybody's anxiety about everything, would you do that?
No. Well, no, absolutely not. Anxiety is, you know, it allows us to anticipate the future, which can be very useful to us in many ways. And that's the value of anxiety, because it allows us to try to charge the brain up a bit and work on the future in a way that makes it important rather than just, something is going to happen in the future.
Yeah, that's sort of what I think too, but I would say that that's why we have it in the first place. Now you and I can disagree about how it came about, but it's
so that would just say that
how it came about may be a spandrel.
Maybe.
So that you have the capacity to imagine the future. And when that is associated with brain arousal and other things like that, that becomes worry.
And what about pathology then? So if it's true that the system by and large does a pretty good job, can we think about cases of pathology, social anxiety, fear of heights, and spiders? So for example, all these things, you should sort of have some of that. I mean, even here in New York City, right. You ought to be, but guess what, the snakes
But you
here.
Don't want to have something that will actually make you stay in your apartment.
Yeah, right, so that just means, that's what I'm getting at. So there's like a setting that gets slightly altered, right? Mm-hmm. Well, maybe again, maybe you should stay in your apartment. I mean, I don't live in New York City. So
well,
I just imagine threats from all corners when I'm here. So it seems like the pathology then is do something that's useful, but to set to a kind of a high or too low level, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but
psychiatrists are very simple-minded people. So if they don't leave the apartment, we know something's wrong. If they can't go to a job, we know something's wrong. So it's a very simple bar. If it's gone to the level where you can no longer function in society or it significantly limits your ability, that's something that it does not seem to be giving you any evolutionary advantage. And that's when you try to give some medication whose mechanism of action we don't understand to that person.
So are you saying to have anxiety as opposed to fear, you have to have cognitive function, or you are saying it's true of both?
I think cognitive functions are required for both.
Exactly. But to have a threat,
it's just a matter of whether the threat is present or worried about in the future.
Yep. But a response to a threat does not require that.
No,
exactly. Yeah.
Just my opinion. So that in essence, what your work is saying is that you can still respond and protect yourself without having the cognitive component
right.
of it.
Exactly. And that the 50 years of work done in rodent models in particular have been studying that type of threat defensive response.
And that's important because it's part of, you know, if this is correct, we need to treat different systems in the brain differently. Exactly. We have to approach psychiatry from the point of view of the way the brain is wired. Mm-hmm. And so it's important to have drugs that will change behavioral inhibition. I mean, behavioral inhibition is often equated with anxiety, and I think that's, you know, part of the problem. We use these words and the semantics of it get us kind of lost in space and confuse things by using the same word for different things.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But you're right. Getting back to what you were saying, in the future, if you could develop either a behavioral probe or some magical nanoparticle that would just go straight to getting to the threat and tamp down a person, a psychiatric patient who had an overactive threat response system, right. Then you might, then it would allow that person to actually go into psychotherapy, for example, and then work
right.
on the,
yeah.
the but other component. Yeah.
That probe would probably affect the same circuit she was asking about
exactly.
that are involved in positive responses to stimulus.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, but
exactly.
through behavioral interactions with
yes.
the patient, like through exposure of specific stimuli, you could be more specific.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, that psychiatry has much more to gain through behavioral than pharmaceutical approaches.
Mm. Exactly. It's sort of stunning that our pharmaceutical agents have worked at all.
Yes. Yeah.
We've given a serotonin reuptake inhibitor that essentially blocks all serotonin reuptake in the entire body.
Well,
there's some studies that show that it doesn't actually work.
When you look at the meta-analyses that actually look very closely, whether it works
close
or
to
not.
Placebo. Yeah.
Well, actually, as one of my colleagues, he's also a psychiatrist, but also a neuroscientist at Stanford. He goes, psychiatrists have used the placebo effect to maximal benefit. Whenever
which
we
is
give
a great thing, it doesn't, if it doesn't have side effect, like
yeah.
most of these
exactly.
drugs have. I mean, I'd rather have people be cured with, you know, sugar pills as a placebo than with these things that have all these terrible side effects.
Exactly. Exactly. That
some of these really though do work, though, right? Like some.
Maybe. No, I think that what my colleagues and I conceptualize is that 30 years ago, 40 years ago, when they were first introduced, the people who had the most severe untreated depression, you got huge effect sizes. And then what you notice is that the effect sizes kept on getting smaller. But so that there is some subset of the depression syndrome, at least, that responds to these. But then we don't have those patients anymore because they're all on these drugs. So that,
everybody's on drugs.
I'll ask one more thing before we go to the audience. Eric had mentioned panic attacks before. So panic attacks are attacks that have to do with anxiety or with fear.
Well, so, you know, there's a specific stimulus, like an interoceptive stimulus, twitching in the chest or chest pain. So you would say that that's a stimulus that is probably then making you anxious, and then that's causing a feed-forward loop.
That's if they don't always exist, that what you just said is not always.
But in that case, the truth is that let's just accept that for the purpose of this, accept what I had described as fear and anxiety. But as soon as you're afraid, it morphs into anxiety, right? So there's a snake at your feet. So you have first your fear of the snake, but immediately you begin to worry about, is it poisonous? Will it bite me? Can I get to the hospital? Will they have the antidote? If I die, will my family be okay? On and on. So that's where I draw the distinction. The snake is there. You have that rapid autonomic nervous system response, and then you kick into worry, and that takes you forward.
It would be very hard to make that distinction to somebody who has the snake. Immediately their thoughts go those ways, right? So it's inevitable in a way in those situations for one and the other to coexist.
Correct. But you could also start with with anxiety, and that, you know, perhaps could
into fear.
No, that could morph into fear. Yeah. Sure.
Somebody who's anxious of crossing a bridge, you take their hand and you go towards the bridge, they start getting pretty afraid. Next thing you know, they leave your hand and run the other way.
Well, Ed also gave an example where anxiety morphs into fear. Maybe, did I lock the door or not? Then the person gets up to check whether they locked the door or not.
I don't want to go off the deep end, but something I found very interesting, you talk about the pharmaceutical approaches and you talk about maybe more of the phenomenological approaches or experiential. When you talk about drugs like hallucinogens, those seem to combine both of those properties. They're both biological and they're seemingly very intense and experiential. Does this interest any of you, or how these drugs both combine these experiences, and yet they're not studied as often as
I think there's a lot of work now on using
hallucinogens. Like four papers on LSD that came out in the last 2 weeks.
What about?
The whole brain connectivity under LSD. Mm-hmm.
But as a therapeutic tool, too, a lot of stuff is happening. I don't know.
You mentioned LSD in a book.
I did?
You did.
You recommended it.
And also, there is a decade ago, we would not be having this conversation, but that now one of the most important or most highly studied drugs for depression is ketamine, because it is, the idea for the way ketamine works is that there is the belief that you have to actually have this sort of dissociative experience in order for it to be effective. So this pharmaceutical industry have made ketamine-like drugs that don't have this dissociative experience and which have fewer side effect profiles, and none of them work as well. There's something that they think is magical about this.
There's some big news on ketamine this week that just came out in your study showing that its effects are due to some metabolic...
Exactly.
So it was the glutamate. Metabolites of ketamine that was actually effective.
Yeah. And the idea that the main target for ketamine had always been thought of one glutamate receptor subtype called the NMDA receptor, and now they think it's the other subtype called the AMPA. So the metabolite might be the active version of it, but these are all rat studies. The human studies are ongoing right now. So it's not clear whether or not that causes, the metabolite might not cause a dissociative effect. That's the key. Mm-hmm.
Actually, there was studies going on at both NYU and Johns Hopkins. At least I read about it last spring on psilocybin, where and I don't know if you're familiar with that, but with people who are people with cancer who are dying and have death anxiety, they've been taking on psilocybin trips, and the images that they've been encountering help eliminate the anxiety. And apparently the anxiety after 6 months is still not there. So I don't know if you're familiar with that study, but it just goes to the other questioner.
Thank you.
So first of all, I just want to say, Mr. Ledoux, you got a little Matthew McConaughey in your voice when you speak.
Well, I'm from Louisiana. I think he's from Texas.
So the thing that
you talked about, the circle thing.
The thing that I have a question about is, and maybe this isn't the appropriate way to ask it, and maybe it's a simplistic way to view the mind, but my question is whether or not minds that are considered creative or logical have different effects in the feeling of anxiety and fear. For example, somebody who might be considered more creative, a creative thinker, having more experience of anxiety than fear in a logical thinker because of the imminent threat, right, going on the definition of time, having the effects right in front of them. So the threat right in front of them. So I'm just curious about your perspective on the kind of the duality of the brain in that sense and its effects on fear and anxiety.
I mean, I would say conceptually it seems right that the person who is more creative and more imaginative and, you know, doing all these kind of anticipatory things are separated, you know, that are not necessarily out there in the present world. Would perhaps be more prone to anxiety, but I don't know if that's actually the case. Psychiatrist, what do you think?
Is that a good way to look at it, or do you think it's flawed in that sense? I mean, is it flawed to think with this topic, right or and left brain or logical?
I think
and
that's flawed.
Creative? Yeah,
right and left brain. Mm-hmm. I mean that, you know, the brain. Right and left comes from primarily from like the split brain work, and there you have left and right for sure. But in the normal brain, everything is connected and crossing and integrated. And so, while it's not appropriate to think about our hemispheres controlling different aspects of personality, that doesn't mean that we don't. Some people aren't more logical, and others more spatial and imaginative, or so forth, in their personality traits. It's just not, perhaps not separated so neatly in terms of the brain.
But maybe the way you can think about it is that if an anxious person manages to help their anxiety by being creative, that's a good way to deal with it. And constructive way to transform the anxiety into a positive thing.
Didn't Gazzaniga feel there were things from the right brain and from the left brain in non-separated hemispheres?
Well, you know, we have to grow up and separate from our parents.
isn't language still a little language is not lateral?
Has he changed his position?
He's not so left-right. I mean, he's still, you know, he's got a little bit of connection to that, but he's not as strong as...
He was.
I mean, some functions are more left or more right. I mean, face perception is more in the right hemisphere, mm-hmm. language is more in the left. Mm-hmm. But doesn't mean, but because the causal connections are so huge and efficient and everything, there is never anything that only happens in one side and stays there.
Hi, thanks a lot for this talk. It's been really educative. The discussion that you guys were having about fear and anxiety that's been going on in the literature for a long time, I know that you've been talking a lot about clarifying terminology. I wonder if it wouldn't be better to talk about this rather as a stress response system and to look at it temporally because of the fact that what we're talking about is, you know, the urgency of response and what level of the nervous system is going to trigger that response. So if you're in a dark alley and somebody touches you in the back, there's going to be an immediate response. And the representation that's going to be there is going to be a very low level reflex. And then the next level would be perhaps at the habit level system. If you're a karate guy, you know, and you have developed these skills over the years, then you would have a more sophisticated representation of your response to that situation. And then you know, if you're watching a movie of somebody being robbed, then the, you're able to access a higher level of representation and abstraction, and okay. you might ask whether he had a good relationship with his mother, you know, mm-hmm. that he's, you know, robbing things.
So I think the analysis you described is dead on, but I would yep. I wouldn't call it a stress system, because that's a whole nother pile of baggage. And
well, I'm sure that people have a more sophisticated or very specific way of talking about okay. stress, but when you're talking about like the amygdala and stuff like that, you know, so much literature has been devoted to, you know, the fear response and things like that. But the amygdala is also has positive valence as well as negative valence. And when you connect the amygdala and the extended amygdala with the periaqueductal gray and the hippocampus, then you've got a system that is addressing different stimuli and classifying that and evaluating and then creating responses according to those schema.
Right. My solution to that is to talk about defensive survival circuit or survival circuits, one of which is defense, others are dealing with other kinds of biologically significant activities. So, but I think, it, you know, we're on the same page there.
All right. My question, thank you. Yes, you mentioned the typical examples of spiders and snakes in eliciting fear and or anxiety, and wouldn't possibly be an altering factor be an expertise and knowledge and being able to differentiate which ones are lethal and which ones aren't lethal affect your reaction to it? Because only a small percentage of snakes are in fact you know, venomous, and those that aren't venomous that would be dangerous, you know, maybe the large constrictors. And as for spiders, all of them technically have venom, but only a few are potent enough to affect us. And then I know if I saw a black widow spider or a brown recluse from the pattern, I would know, you know, that there were bad news. Or a tarantula, if it bit me, I'd probably experience something like a bee sting. But other than that, if I saw an orb spider, I wouldn't think twice about it. So I guess would that alter someone's response, or is, you know?
I mean, the as you guys can say better than me, but the phobias are not sensitive to information and logic. Or, you know, so there's no amount of reasoning that this is not dangerous and this is going to change their response to the snake, at least as I understand.
Right.
I
would say it's genetically encoded, like inevitable that you're going to be panic if you see something in a broad classification, even though it's not venom, even though it's not dangerous.
Mm-hmm. It's better to react too many times than to miss one time. So it's better to react to a non-venomous snake than think, oh yeah, well maybe not, and you know, so we are primed to have quick reactions to things of a category that are potentially.
Yeah, I just don't want to squander it on those. I just like to reserve it for those things that could actually harm me.
And not waste
anxiety on something that's.
Yeah, but we're talking about things that are happening in less than 100 milliseconds. You don't have time to do all these, you know, thinking analysis. About does it have a cross on it or not.
I'm just saying, if knowledge is accumulated over a period of time that you can recognize it instantly.
Less than 100 milliseconds, yeah. Nobody can recognize it.
It's also not that simple, because there's lots of mimicry among poisonous critters in nature, right? Yeah. So aposematic coloring, right? So that just means that if I'm a non-poisonous snake and there's a poisonous snake that kind of looks like me, selection is going to favor me looking even more like the poisonous guy, because the benefits I get from other critters being afraid of me. So it's actually, so there's two things. One is there's a problem of maximizing expected value, which means false, you know, you do a lot of false positives and try to avoid misses. But the other one is mimicry really undermines these systems, and they move faster than we probably do in terms of the selective history. It's a problem.
But he does have a point about education helping with fear. And that's basic to human learning.
I have a question which may be a slight detour. But speaking as a layperson, and particularly a layperson in terms of the way in which most of the question is being addressed in terms of remedy, cause and remedy. And so my question is really about fear as not what happens to create fear, but what happens when we have fear. And is So various questions, related questions about that. What is that? What's it doing? What does it do? Is it bad? When is it good? Can it be used? What happens when conflicting fears come together? What does that feel like? And what does that make us do? And also thinking about, I kind of sidetracked to the sidetrack, talking about fear as temporal, I'm thinking we can imagine the present too. We can be in a present situation, and obviously we don't necessarily know everything about the situation that we're in, and it may be an ongoing situation or a situation that's not like the appearance of a snake. So it can be something that goes on for half an hour and a half, whatever. And so what's our imagination about a situation that we're actually in, which is not necessarily a bad thing? And I'm not, again, not talking about necessarily the remedial.
Speechless.
Sorry.
I think probably we agree with what you're saying, that there's a complex series, that one can't substitute for another. We got into that discussion about the snake automatically triggering the neurophysiology very rapidly of fear, but whether that is fear or what we mean by fear and the higher cortical representation of that, which doesn't mean that that doesn't happen, and it doesn't always mean that that happens. They're actually related but different. And so when you're describing different categories of complexity, essentially, I think most of us sitting here would say right on.
But I think maybe the essence of my question is about whether fear can be good and what we can do, for example, about going inside fear rather than necessarily going to the solution of getting rid of it.
Yes, I think all of us would agree from the adaptive to the psychoanalytic.
Right. I mean, from an evolutionary perspective, if you imagine what it would be like for our ancestors who felt no fear, they were not our ancestors because they're dead. They got
bitten by snakes.
They got bitten by a snake, or they were sticking their hand in fire or whatever they were doing. It didn't work out so well. So yeah, there's no doubt, at least not in my mind, that fear is a very functional part of the architecture. We need our fear.
Yeah.
Right. And not just that, but it's got to be complicated because there's lots of things that are threatening to people. There's pathogens and there's other people and there's big cats and over evolutionary time, there were lots of ways that you could come to an end. I mean, we're really complicated. And the thing about complicated things is if you just perturb them a little bit, they become damaged and no longer able to work, right? So to keep us healthy, you got to do all this cool stuff. But to disable us, all I need is a little ice pick and I'm done. I mean, it's really simple to disorder very complicated systems. So fear is basically the way to say, look, here's a thing in the world that could damage me, could harm my fitness interests, and then motivate me to take appropriate action. Now, for some reason, we have phenomenology associated with that. Maybe we don't need that. But at least insofar as the reactions to the stimuli, those are definitely good for us. And yes, if you were insufficiently afraid, then you would be in big trouble. And the other way too, right? So some of the clinical friends can tell us about the dangers of being too afraid of the world so that you stay in your apartment, which here I'm understanding is very small, which is a great reason for everyone to move to Philadelphia. Anyway, so sure. And then if you're asking about the phenomenology, I mean, I think that's a hard question. Why does it feel like something to be afraid? I think you could ask that of why does it feel like something to be anything? And that's hard. And I think, some of the things that we've heard here, especially Joe and others' work, has spoken to that a little bit.
Mm-hmm. No. I mean, okay. I'm still hearing the remedial, even inside the embracing of the fear. But
okay. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks for letting us listen in. I have a question that I hope kind of ties things together because it has a couple of components of things that have come up. And one of them is, let's say last night I had a dream of falling. And one of the things that we talked about was mice, and one of the things we talked about was humans. But we didn't really talk about the in-between very much in terms of the complexity of brains and processes that can happen. My understanding, or at least I think that there's some question that dream of falling comes from great ancestors back in the day. And to me, that would seem like something that's anxious. And so I wonder about anxiety and fear in primates and things that are more advanced. though they don't have a clear language, but they have some form of communication. How much information has been garnered from that kind of study?
Well, because we can't ask them, we have to just go on their behavior. And so when we're looking at behavior, if depending on how close we want to stick to the data, we can describe it in terms of their threat responses or the responses to danger and leave it at that. Or we can speculate about things that we can't prove, which would be to say that there's a state of fear that intervenes between processing of the threat and the control of the responses. So at this point, it's a matter of where what your comfort level with is and what your approach to the science of it is to whether you want to put that subjective experience in the middle of the responses, when we know from human studies that you don't need that experience in order to get some of these responses.
The dream of falling comes in to
the
me
dream I'm going to turn over
it's
to
like
my
a very cognitively up there sort of thing. And so to me, I do think that that's something that, you know, animals, I mean, I watch my pets dream and they twitch and whine, and I imagine they have anxiety when that happens and fear. I don't want to try to separate the two.
So I go home every day, I pet my cat and he purrs and I think he's feeling good and so we're good together and that's fine. But when I'm in the lab, I can't allow myself that kind of supposition. So you can feel whatever you want about
the interesting thing about animal dreams is, you know, they did these studies where they would cut the thing that when you dream, you're paralyzed. When you and you can, but if you cut that and you let the motor system work in cats, you can see that the cat is rehearsing everything that makes a cat a cat. I mean, the attack, the hiss, the mates, they have all these dreams that sort of reinforce all the circuitry that is important for their species. So I think that's animals do dream, but I think it's rehearsal of things that happen in the days. And
is that also true of humans?
I don't think the IRB has approved that experiment.
But wait, there's a separate question. The question is, do you think that one function of human dreaming may very well be to practice the sort of things that we as humans...
Yes, if you ask people what they dream about, that's a significant proportion.
Mark, can we get your input on this?
Although we can't, as you say, we can't make the same cut in humans, severing locus coeruleus from the alpha... motor neurons, there is a naturally occurring condition, REM behavior disorder, which is due to a degenerative process in the midbrain, which is sort of roughly the same area. And so we do have humans who act out their dreams. The interesting thing is, if you go with your statement that what the cats do is everything that makes them a cat, what humans do is mostly aggressive. Very, very aggressive, to the point that it is literally dangerous to your sleeping partner if you have REM behavior disorder.
So. It's better if you are single, then.
Maybe it makes you aggressive to have REM behavior disorders.
Or maybe we come from an evolutionary history that turned a lot of aggression among our species.
Mm. Oh, there's more questions. I didn't realize.
Yeah.
I think we've pretty much resolved the issue that anxiety is a necessary part of human mental experience, and we would be in bad shape if we didn't have it. One thing that also is specifically human is superego anxiety. So I'm wondering if there's been any attempt to study what circuitry might be involved when some kind of stimulus that stimulates superego anxiety as opposed to just something like a snake.
Can you describe what that would be?
Yes, what Ed said about the religion being,
yes,
you read religion
it was,
and then you don't.
Right, it was Ed's question that actually got me thinking about this, whether there would be some way to elicit that kind of response by showing a stimulus that has to do with something that would arouse a superego response, like seeing something like torture. Right. And I'm just wondering if there's been any study of pathways that would be so specifically human that would have to do with anxiety.
I don't know anything, but that could be there.
The only thing that I know that's getting slightly close to that is an experiment that we've done, and it's not published yet, but we had MIT student take an oath and then have an experiment, do an experiment where they could cheat or not, mm-hmm. and they would make money. And those who were under oath, and it was not to a god or anything, it was to their university, and first they cheated less, and when they were losing money because they were telling the truth, the whole actually reward system was going up. So it was rewarding to
lose
because you were under oath and you had sworn not to cheat. So that's the
only great
thing that can get that.
That's a good thing about some humans.
Well, you folks succeeded in arousing quite a number of thoughts and questions in my mind. But let me start with a thought experiment. Can you imagine that you are a gnu and that you are migrating in the Serengeti in Africa? And suddenly you look around and you see many other gnus are running like crazy. So you rejoin and run. Now, you have not been frightened by a snake. You have not been told something is dangerous. There's
been
no communication. Nobody has said anything. So, and another a matter about it is that these gnus, although they may be, especially if they're old and wounded, they may be susceptible to being attacked by lions or other things, but they have probably survived many more generations, because they don't live as long as humans, but quite a long time, without speech and without fear and without anxiety, or at least if they have it that we don't know about it. And as a matter of fact, there are other species which have been around much longer than that, like turtles. Turtles have been around for a long, long time. So the question of what is the use of consciousness and fear and anxiety and all the attempts we make to make distinctions, what good is it? That's one thing. Second point is about the placebo effect. Now, what do we know about the placebo effect? When I was a fellow and after my psychiatry residency, I worked with Mort Reiser. It was a period when psychosomatics was changing from being explained by Freudian concepts like an ulcer is what happens when you incorporate your mother and she bites you in the stomach. And it changed to what are the physiological accompaniments of hypertension and so on. And we did a little funky experiment, which was that we just got some subjects and we put them on a couch and we had them look at a light that flashed, a subliminal flash, just so that you'd know that there was a flash. There was nothing in it. Other people were trying to describe how, let's say, a rebus in such a thing could stimulate thoughts, fantasies, and so forth. We just asked these people to close their eyes after they had seen this light and let something come to mind, some picture come to mind, and then they could draw it, and then they could give it a title. And we came to a conclusion, which is not so remarkable, that the main effect of the experiment had to do with how they conceived of it and what their relationship was to the experimenter. And some people, well, the activation was, I think, kept me out of the army at the time of the Vietnamese War, because I think that the CIA discovered that this had something to do with lie detector test, because we used skin resistance, among other things. And you could chart this, and then you could compare with what they imaged and what they drew. And one very impressive person, at least I was very impressed, drew a picture of Don Drysdale throwing a ball, and it was coming right to him. And this was going boom, 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 boom. And then, after a few minutes, everything calmed down. And when we asked if he could remember what he had done, That was left out. He forgot it. He was a sort of a, went into a doze after. We were very curious about this, but we couldn't get refunded, so I gave up the thing. But you know that this is that there is a negative aspect of placebo effect also. And it's also it's been very, very interesting to me that people say that we have to compensate for the placebo effect because it may give a beneficial result when the drug isn't doing it and so on and so forth. But it also depends on how the experiment is set up, I would think, and how the person responds to it, whether it's positive or negative. And it's very important, of course. And but it also goes back to the other point about the gnus. There is so much communication between animals and between humans, which is not on a verbal level, but which has obviously got complicated content and communications. And how we can really learn by just depending on the words, what the report is of something. Now, the last week or a week before, I had a TIA, and I was sitting in a meeting with some colleagues, some psychoanalysts from France, and I was having a happy conversation with one of these people when it came about that I couldn't talk, I couldn't make words, I couldn't think of how to speak, and I just had to sit there, blah 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 blah. But I must tell you, if you asked me how that felt, was I fearful? Was I anxious? I wasn't fearful and I wasn't anxious. After it went away and I started going to doctors and they were going through all kinds of possible diagnoses and this and that, then I got anxious.
Okay.
In retrospect, I knew that it was, that it was somehow hazardous. But, I mean, all of this is churning around in my mind and I thank you for it.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll do something.
Thank you. Last question.
So also want to add my voice to comment. I've been in a lot of these sessions. This was one of the best I've ever been to. This was, I think, a really, really terrific discussion. And I treat PTSD for a living, so nevertheless, I found that you were able to manage to interest me as well as people who were at all different levels of this. But there were two very simple clinical observations. I don't feel comfortable leaving this discussion without making the point that it's very common right now to talk about the placebo effect of SSRIs, and I have to completely agree with Francis, both from my clinical experience with about 10,000 severely depressed inpatients over a course of a lifetime and my own recurrent severe depressions, that SSRIs are incredibly effective when that, and it's really dangerous if we don't make that clear to people on the outside. That what's happened is diagnostic creep, so that there are a lot of people who are on SSRIs who maybe oughtn't to be. But for severe depression, I don't think there's, I've just seen it too many times, seen it with other people and myself, it's a light switch and it makes a huge difference, life-saving difference. And I think within the scientific discourse about that, we have to be clear because there's already too much resistance to taking medication among people with severe depression, point one. The second point is that in treating lots and lots of PTSD patients, I found that one of the most, I do exposure therapy and things, but one of the most effective things that I've done is, that, and just sort of stumbled on this, is at the beginning of the whole treatment process, I will say to the patient, and usually these have been non-sophisticated, psychologically non-sophisticated people, cops, firemen, metal workers, other 9/11 exposed people, I'll say, the issue here is that your life, your feelings, and your behavior are run by a committee inside of your head, and you are not invited to committee meetings. And the goal of this is to get you invited to committee meetings. It's a very simple metaphor, but it's the metaphor about the non-unity of mind, which I think we have such an evolutionarily powerful drive to have a sense of unity of mind, that when you tell this to people, it's an incredible sense of relief and an incredible new model for them.
Thank you. Bravo. Yeah. Okay.